Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining me tonight on A World Awakening. I'm very, very pleased and proud and happy to announce that our special guest tonight is Mr. Stephen Bassett. If you're a follower of the show, then you know that even before Tony Rathman and I joined KGRA, digital broadcasting. We had Stephen on, and the night that we had him on, probably about a year and a half ago or so, we had 2.5 hours with him. Well, tonight we only have an hour, so I am going to do my utmost to, and Bill will let me know when he's got him in the queue, so it gives me, you know, a moment or two to speak glowingly about this remarkable man. Stephen exemplifies what I consider a commitment to the cause of human enlightenment. He is a stellar intellect. He is a formidable force to be reckoned with, and he is an advocate for humanity. I really can't think of more important banners to attach to any particular individual than that. He has an ability to captivate a room in his lectures so that when he is done speaking, at least I'll speak for myself, I feel all sparkly and tingly and inspired and re-energized, because it can be very draining and difficult to constantly feel like you're just screaming into hurricane force winds about our galactic family. And there are times that it feels like no one's listening, nobody's really paying attention. We're just not making any progress or headway in terms of this subject matter, but instead revisiting the same subject over and over again, but not making any real quantum leaps in our understanding. Now, as individuals who are contactees, myself included, yeah, I'm very comfortable with the progress that I have made throughout the course of my life in terms of my own understanding. But when I encounter another individual who has the ability to cohesively, coherently, and inspirationally impart information that is perhaps unfamiliar or even foreign to other people, he takes what is mysterious, what has its own mystique, and is able to communicate it in such a way that it breeds familiarity. It takes away, it pulls down those guardrails that so many people put in place because they're afraid that if they dare to believe what he's saying or what I'm saying or others that work in this field, that it somehow threatens to fracture their own belief system, that it shatters notions that they've lived with lifelong, and that it is a challenge and in some ways a threat to their ability to comprehend the universe. Well, let's start here. The universe is incomprehensible. Probably the most famous quotation that I've put out in the world that keeps showing up all over the place over and over again is, let me get this right, The safest assumption that we can make is that we know nothing in comparison to what there is to know. This, in the vein of Carl Sagan and so many others that came before us, who were unafraid to bridge that gap, to make that leap, quantum leap, in our understanding of who we are, our existence in the context of an ever-expanding universe, is very difficult for the human mind to wrap itself around. And Stephen has an ability, an inherent, innate ability to close that gap. So, Bill, just let me know when we've got him in the queue and we'll bring him on. And in the interim, let me just tell you, while I stall for a little time, it's actually, hi.
Hey there. Well,
I know you.
Steve is in the backstage and he's ready to go. So I'm going to bring him on.
Excellent. Excellent. I can save this little story, this little vignette for another time. There he is. You know, Steve, I don't know if you heard the nice things that I had to say about you.
Rats. But
let me say it in your presence. You are a stellar intellect, a brilliant man, and an inspiration to me and many, many others. And I am deeply grateful that you were able to join us tonight on the show.
Thank you. And let me see if I can add some light to this one moment.
Okay. Oh, he's gone.
I think this may be an improvement.
Oh, I love your office. Oh, it makes you all dark and mysterious anyway. You know, I mean, you're just, it's lovely. Your office is beautiful, dear.
Thank you. I spent months working on it. It's good to be with you again, Andrea. I hope your life is going well. You've got lots of projects in the works. What can I tell you? What do you need to know?
Well, you know, this whole thing. All right. So when I was filling your space at Starworks last November, mm-hmm. one of the things that I did was get up on that stage and I felt your presence with me because unfortunately you were ill. I'm so glad to see you looking so well. And you were not able to join us. And so Paula Harris gave me your spot in the lineup. And I was honored by that. In a, you know, kind of bizarre way. It's almost like I was, let me channel Steve, you know, he can't be here, but what would Steve say? And the one thing that I wanted to bring to your attention before I let you run with this is that during my lecture, I talked about the gathering of the 16 intellects from around the world that the DOD had gathered together.
Yeah.
And then said, let's explore this subject. And then they handed them all of the declassified material on UFOs, or what they like to call UAPs, because, oh, let's change the subject a little more. And I said, probably arrogantly, had I been one of those people sitting around the table, I would have taken the file folder. And I would have shoved it back to the person that gave it to me and said, you know what? This is an all or nothing proposition. You didn't gather people from MIT and every other major university and research center in the world so that we could look at what you've already decided was safe enough for us to look at. We're at a point now where we're tired of breadcrumbs when we're hungry for the truth and we want the whole loaf. Give us everything or I'm out of here. And there it is. So run with it. Tell me what you gleaned from the second only congressional hearing on UFOs in Washington, D.C. yesterday that was maybe something beyond the same old, same old. Do they pose a threat? We don't know if they exist or not. Bullshit. What do you think?
You've probably seen the scene in more than a few movies where the protagonist is in some awful situation and they literally can't, they have no food. and maybe no water, but certainly no food. They go weeks and weeks, months without any food. They're starving to death. They've shrunk down to skin and bones. And finally, the people come to save them, right? And then they put some food in front of them, and they start trying to. They're incredibly starving, and they're stuffing themselves. And this is very bad. It'll kill you. You can't do that, right? When you have been starved for weeks, and you've lost a huge amount of weight, and then it suddenly try to eat everything at once and kill you. This is kind of the situation with the OP issue. People have been waiting 75 years to finally get the proper confirmation on this issue from their government, which has known about the ET presence since Roswell, possibly a little sooner. There's a couple of events, right? But in terms of but so little emerged from those events, if they did take place, Cape Girardeau and others, that it just wasn't a thing, all right? But after Roswell, it was a thing because they put a press release out, you know?
They once told the truth and then immediately retracted it, yeah.
Nothing like putting out a press release to really get things going.
Yeah.
And of course, there's, I think, a very significant matrix of evidence that ETs have been engaging the human race for thousands of years. The evidence is much more difficult, obviously, to run down, but the totality of it is such that it's impossible to look at history. And of course, the one entity, the one thing that's doing this with vigor is Ancient Aliens, and there are people that hate it. Certainly the historians and archaeologists, it drives them crazy. The point is that a lot of it's right. It's just that simple. And they've gone over it repeatedly. They've made corrections. So they've been around. They've been dealing with this. Maybe different ETs, different types. Who knows? I'm sure they visited the planet before we had what we'll call civilization, or before there were even Homo sapiens sapiens. Whatever. They can come and go when they please. However, we're concerned now about the modern era. And the modern era is much different. We by 46-7, we had the beginning of a global civilization, advanced communications, media, journalism, and so forth. And so when a press release goes out into that kind of a situation, it has great impact. So, okay, but it did not go further. The government made a decision to embargo this issue. I call it an embargo, which is what it is, for national security reasons. But that press release went out, and the ETs, of course, can do what they please. And so this has created this extraordinary 75-year period. I think nothing like it has ever happened before in the history of the human race, to be honest with you. If somebody's got a similar example, let me know, where a government, and in this case, a government in a constitutional republic with substantial rights to the citizens, speech and everything else, made a national security decision that it would just pretend that something that people were seeing with their own eyes daily, worldwide, didn't exist. And that they would not only just pretend it didn't exist, they would go to various degrees to prevent people from engaging it, covering it, talking about it, to the extent, just contain it, right? And this had to be a daily thing. It had to go on relentlessly because the ET phenomena was simply going to happen. And there was nothing they could do about that. And they managed to pull it off. Now, to be fair, complete, they did get the compliance with their allies. The allies, post-World War II allies of the United States, went along with this without exception. That helped a great deal because people might be pressing our president or our Department of Defense or whatever, why don't you tell us more? Then they look around and they're not getting it. Nothing's coming out of the UK. Nothing's coming out of France or Germany. And nothing's coming out of our adversary nations, such as the Soviet Union and China. All of the nations are pretty much part of the embargo, though the United States had to be the most vigorous about it. Some of the authoritative countries, all you had to do was say, do not touch that. Do not say anything there or we will kill you. And people go, okay, no problem. U.S., no, no. So the U.S. had to be vigorous, and it had to keep its allies in line by offering support and protection from the big bad wolf and substantial economic benefits. And so all of this and many, many other factors were in play to somehow get us from 47, right, to 2023. and the confirmation of what was announced in a press release 76 years ago still hasn't happened. This is an amazing thing. Now, the point I'm getting at is that it created this extraordinary tension between the government's policy of embargo and a public with ever-increasing ability to discover, research, learn about this phenomenon, to publish books about it, do documentaries, and of course, countless sightings that were taking place and being reported. And so this tension is building up with a growing number of people within our country who know damn well this thing is real, and a government that still says, we don't know what you're talking about. And that's irritating. And it's not just, gee, I'm irritated because I don't know this. People invested their lives, substantial amount of their resources. They put their heart and soul into trying to get at this truth, and it did not, was not getting confirmation. Many have perished, like in many long, other examples of very long activist efforts to get justice, to get truth. There have been many. They go on, and people don't live long enough to see the outcome, to see the prize.
And
so this is a serious matter, and so the emotional connection, particularly the researchers and the more active people, but also people that just know, is very high. And so guess what? As the heroes arrive with the food and the buffet for the incredibly starving people, mm-hmm. they want to rush in and they want to wolf that whole buffet down. They want to eat it in one shot, and that can't happen.
Well,
so you're getting my point here.
Yes. Bill wants to know, is the bottom line all about funding in the name of an adversarial threat for R&D, data collection, staff, and military industrial complex while discounting the ET phenomena? Thank you for that question, Bill.
The answer is no. No. For most of the history of the truth embargo, going back to 47, it was a pretty straightforward national security matter. The government was convinced that the knowledge of this presence and possible, and also eventually knowledge of ET technology in our hands would destabilizing an ever serious and developing threat. And that was not ETs. They knew early on the ETs were not a
threat.
Always a potential threat. Right. But not a threat. The threat was the Soviet Union and eventually China and what would eventually be 80,000+ nuclear weapons that were in stocks around the world and 2000 some testing that had been done, giving a lot of us cancer. That was the threat. And they felt that just dropping this paradigm shift, this worldview, staggering worldview change into that unpredictable mix was simply too dangerous. And so national security, until it's appropriate, we don't know what you're talking about. Meanwhile, of course, we're studying it big time. Oh, we're putting huge amounts of money into studying it, right? And yeah, that brought money to the Department of Defense and to black programs, yes. Yeah. Re-engineering programs, I'm sure a lot of money was spent. But I would speculate that the amount of money that has been spent dealing with the ET issue in terms of hard research tracking and the truth embargo itself is a tiny fraction of the money that was spent in just fundamental national security, which means building nuclear submarines, nuclear missiles, vast facilities, having hundreds of thousands of troops all over the world in I don't know how many hundreds of bases that we have, believe me. So the idea that, oh, they're pushing the ET thing now to get more money, believe me, they have tons of money. They have more money than they could possibly spend, frankly, and they managed to spend it anyway. In fact, right now, it was recently announced that they're going ahead with a new submarine program, a new nuclear sub program, in which will cost $118 billion, with each one running around $9 billion apiece. And I assure you, none of these nuclear submarines have a damn thing to do with extraterrestrials, right? Other than they'll be turning up extraordinary undersea objects on their radar or sonar, just like our current subs do. So no, it's not that. It was a national security decision. So, and as I've said many times, and I'm glad to say it again, what is it we are seeing here? What is in fact going on? And this is where it gets interesting. Because if you're a millennial and born, say, I think the earliest millennials, we'll say 1990. Some say it goes a little before that, but we'll say 1990. If you're a millennial and you were born in 1990, you're 33 today. You were 3 years old when Lawrence Rockefeller approached the Clinton administration about, let's get the files out, and started a process that had been involving the administration and Hillary Clinton and Podesta and so forth. And he gave it a run. And the Department of Defense, forget about it. You know, sorry, wrong president. We don't like you anyway. We're not giving you anything. They were, let's see. Let's move forward. So they were 11 when Stephen Greer holds a major press conference, the National Press Club, bringing forward a number of witnesses in person to testify in front of about 150 media, as well as videotaping of about another 75. It was a major event. They were 11 years old.
Yeah.
Then in, let's see, that was 2001. They were 14 when the first X conference was held. They were 23 when the citizen hearing on disclosure mock congressional hearing was held. And so you see where I'm going here? They have no understanding of this issue really prior to 2000, really, unless they have really dived into it. And they've got a very complex world to deal with, and making a living and paying for $50,000 a year tuitions to go to college. And so they're just looking at what's happening as if it's just happening, right? And by that I mean, if I were them, and a lot of others even much older, right, this is not limited to millennials, I would be thinking, oh goodness, our government has learned that there is a phenomena out there, craft or something flying through the sky, and we don't know what it is. And it's really appropriate, because it could be a potential threat to our national security, that we start reporting that and creating an actual formal entity to do that, right? And we probably need some legislation about that. And so, yeah, and so people are going, well, this is good. I mean, this is exactly what I would expect, except the government's already known about it since 47. The government's been tracking and researching in the deepest classified programs for 75 years. Well, that's, so then what's going on? Here's what's going on. By 2017, enough people within the complete United States government, all of the services, the agencies, including the intelligence agencies, as well as staff on the Hill, members of Congress, whatever, throughout that entire collective, the number of people that had either was directly involved in with a need to know, or had already figured out and or been tipped off, or just on their own through intelligent, thoughtful analysis, because the stuff has all been in the public domain for years, understand that there's an extraterrestrial presence. And that kind of reached a critical mass where it was possible for some of them to make what we'll call independent moves. And those that action happened to come from 10 individuals that emerged in October of 2017, and subsequently was followed by two groundbreaking articles in the New York Times. Everybody knows about this.
Oh yeah.
And they weren't just any articles. There were two over two period of days in the print front page, but then it was all up on the website. Mm-hmm. But what was on the website was not just an article about a program and some people or whatever. What was on that website was three gun camera clips released by the Department of Defense to certain individuals and then sent to the New York Times, which put them up on the website. Now, a lot of people are going, but we still don't know what they were. True. And some very sharp, what we'll call citizen skeptics, of a higher quality, frankly, than we were used to years ago, have done some analysis on these videos, and they have concluded that some of the aspects of it, which are quite intriguing, actually may very well be simply the result of the equipment that was tracking them. All right, fine. Which takes a little of the mystery out, though it still doesn't show what they are. But that's not what's important.
No.
What's important was, and again, this is the activist perspective, is that the Department of Defense put out, gave three videos to people they knew were pursuing this issue, right? The truth on this issue, disclosure, which had never been done before.
never have any gun camera clips from any country that could ostensibly either connected to a real UAP sighting, or at least by virtue of the fact that the government was indicating that or implying that that was the case. It has never happened in the entire history of this issue. And so when those things turned up on the New York Times, that was essentially the breakpoint. From that,
you consider that full disclosure?
No, not at all. I consider that the beginning of the end of the truth embargo. The truth embargo, at the moment those article hit, for the last 6 years, and it could have been a lot sooner, has been a dead lie walking. Right? Those videos have been seen hundreds of millions of times. The stills from them have turned up in articles by the thousands for the last 6 years. They are relentless, which drives the skeptics crazy because they know, well, it doesn't actually show it. It proved that it's a UAP, and so it's wrong that they put that out there. And they go, please chill out, okay? Why? Why chill out? Because it wasn't about the New York Times is going to prove this issue finally. It was about the fact that 10 individuals with careers in the military intelligence complex came forward and said, we're pursuing the truth in this issue. And there's extraordinary things you need to know. And we're going to go about it in an orderly way. And that's what we knew as of the end of 2017. And what has happened since is that whole thing has been unfolding in an appropriate way that you would expect given a breakthrough like those articles. Now, another reason for the frustration, and this is just bad luck, right? History can be really tough, is that, okay, the New York Times puts those articles out, which I assure you are being read worldwide and triggering all kinds of internal responses within the agencies, within the services, within the Congress, everything else. What? All kinds of responses. That was the end of 2019. I'm sorry, 2017.
2000.
The political situation was chaotic.
Yes.
Unprecedented. Oh. Right? All right.
My favorite word. Yeah. Okay.
I'm not getting partisan here. I'm just saying it was chaos is chaos. I don't care who produces it. Yeah. And we're dealing with that and maybe trying to get a handle on that. Because as for this issue to go forward, given its scope and power and importance, it's something very precious that you don't want to put on an airplane and fly through a hurricane to get where it needs to go, right? You need to wait for the storm to pass. And so they were kind of seeing how things were going political. And I believe at a point when possibly they were seeing a way forward, pandemic shows up. Not just any pandemic, the largest pandemic in history in terms of the total number of people affected, the largest by far in terms of the economic impact, it was a global catastrophe, yes. All right? And gee, that's kind of a problem. And so that has slowed everything down, obviously. And yet, in spite of the fact that the political chaos has continued, the pandemic lasted a good solid 2 years, is still around 3 years in, and isn't going away anytime soon. 100 people die every day.
Every day.
Right? In the U.S., around the world, I forget the number. We are making tremendous progress. Okay. Progress toward what? Progress toward disclosure, which is the reason those people came out and what this has all been about. So what do you mean, Steve? Disclosure is the confirmation event, comes from the president, can only come from the president. Could be another head of state. It's up to them. Right now, it's still in the hands of our president, which is good. I kind of like that.
Yeah,
that confirmation event ends the truth embargo. The whole issue of is there a non-human intelligence and tech present is settled. It's fact. It's done. And all of the obscuring and all of the truth embargo stuff is in the past. It would be like, hey, you know, let's move on. Let's move forward. And then all the doors start opening and we are in the post-disclosure world. The thing is, how do you get to that confirmation statement from the president when the government has been virtually lying about it, denying it, and coercing it for 75 years? You just rip the band-aid up and go, hey, yeah, they've always been here. Sorry, didn't mean to tell you. No, you cannot do that.
No, it's drip, drip, drip.
Well, don't think of it as drip, drip, drip. Think of it as protocol, appropriate protocol. There's always been a drip, 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 but the government didn't have to do the dripping. The citizens were doing the dripping. They were out finding stuff out, writing books, putting it out there. The government needed to drip anything. The civilian population.
We are the ones doing the dripping.
Okay.
Yep.
And, yes, go ahead.
No, we had a question. Are there other governments that are more open with their citizens about our galactic family? I can answer that. Of releasing cherry-picked information, I think the UK is ahead of us. I can't really think of any other countries. France, Germany have released some elements of their records. But again, you know, I would say probably in the 90 percentile or more is still considered classified. And, you know, maybe I am thinking about this wrong. Because I was, you know, I was a fist pumping, screaming banshee of demanding, and Mexico, yes, Victoria, demanding disclosure for a decade before I realized that was futile, fruitless, and I came to the conclusion. Instead of banging on doors and insisting that people tell us what I knew they knew, that we are the point of disclosure. We, the contactees, we, the researchers, we, the people that are working, diligently on this subject all the time. And we are a collective worldwide of credible people with incredible stories to share.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Sure. You, the citizen science researchers, journalists, documentarians, witnesses, and so forth, and contactees, all right, they have been the principal delivery mechanism for information on this issue, not our government. And so in terms of looking at all the governments, in terms of the amount of information that has come out overall from all sources, there's no question. U.S.-based information is surpasses every other country, yes. But other countries have released some things, and the government has done a few things. But the primary body of information and research is mostly centered on the United States, and because our government has been leading the truth embargo, not surprisingly, a lot of the citizen researchers are finding stuff in our government, so they're pulling it out. With FOIA docs and witnesses coming forward, so it is there has been a process of what we'll call the small d disclosure going on at a number of levels, including at the government level, for these 75 years. It ebbs and it flows, but it's always been a continuing revealing process. But it was not allowed to reach a threshold that would trigger political action. Mm-hmm. See, this is a political issue, not a science issue. That's what I figured out when I left John Mack's and the group as a volunteer and went to Washington and registered lobbyists. You could pile science on top of science. It doesn't matter. The government's embargoed it. That's it. That's it. End of story. And of course, because the government has embargoed it, the universities are going to stay out of it. The research organizations stay out of it. Funders are going to stay out of it. So it all comes together very nicely to maintain the truth embargo. That is coming to an end. Now, to get to my key point here. All right. What is going on now is because it's so complex, and you've got all the military services that are going to have issues to deal with. The Congress is going to have issues to deal with. Certainly all of the intelligence agencies, as well as all the civilian research, government or defense contractors, all of these people and entities are going to be affected by the disclosure event. And it's not going to be generally positive. It's going to be negative. Now, as it happens, a great proportion of the people that managed and maintained this truth embargo or worked on this issue in classified ways are dead. And so
yes,
they don't got a problem. A lot of the people that are involved now are relatively new. And so they're going to be able to say, I came in, we did this program, right? I didn't start this thing. But nevertheless, you've got reputations and you've got stability issues and you have credibility issues with the government and the White House and everything else. So you just can't do it. So what we're seeing is that they are going through a process, which is exactly what should have happened in 1948. Right. Truman could have made the decision not to call Ramey and put out a second press conference. He could have said, let's see what's going on here. Let's see how the people react as this story starts spreading through the country, right? And then we'll decide. And what they would have found out is that the country would have been quite fine with it. It's not War of the Worlds nonsense. They just went through World War II, for crying out loud, right?
Yeah, if they could survive that, they can survive this. And I noticed as well, before I bring up our last question that just came in, I noticed I am an observer, you know, above all else. And when the New York Times did their big splash in 2017, mm-hmm. I watched what happened around that. Yes. Credible source, right out of the Navy, video attached off the USS Nimitz.
Sure.
How did the country react?
Well, they loved it.
They loved it. And it went to ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, even Fox. The Faux News Network even covered it religiously. You know, and I'm thinking, wow, this has just touched every person who's conscious in this country. You know, is anyone freaking out? You know, do we suddenly have a burgeoning of hospital visits because people's minds are blown? No. And I think the reason is, Steve, they already knew.
They
what we already knew. And I don't mean knew because of Roswell or any other press release or any other commentary. Mm-hmm. I think that it is part of our consciousness. And it has been for as long as you and I have been alive and prior to that, because as a contactee myself, which began in my early childhood, I knew my whole life that we were not alone in the universe. And I spoke openly about it to anyone who would listen. And I never cared if anybody said, that's a bunch of hooey. It didn't bother me because the truth was more important to me to, you know, put that out, what speak my truth. And I'm just one of millions of people around the world that have had direct contact with extraterrestrials. Do I know them personally by name? Do I know what races they are? No. Do I feel any threat at all? No. They've never done anything but help and heal me and guide me through this crazy nonsense called life on planet Earth. And so the more of us speak up, and you've addressed this in many of your lectures, you know, encouraging people, speak your truth, talk about it. You know,
if you can,
have you gathered at this conference? Have you gathered at this symposium? Mm-hmm. You didn't accidentally stumble in the door. You were drawn here. You came here with purpose and reason. Candace wants to know why we're only getting information from the Navy instead of other elements of the armed forces. Do you have any kind of, you know, what's your take on that?
It's not significant. The Air Force, the Navy is fairly prominent because the 2014 cases are kind of dominating the scene. In other words, you can't take all of the cases that have happened on this issue and try to ram them through the front of the Capitol building, get people to deal with it. You need something as a touchstone. And these are Navy cases. It's also the case that the Air Force has the worst reputation on this issue. It has the worst history, and it's going to have the most difficult time public relations-wise once it comes out. So they're, I think, wisely kind of staying in the background and just keeping their mouth shut. I kind of get that. But it doesn't really matter. What matters is that it's all coming out. Now, to finish the point that I was making, which is very important. Again, what is going on is what could have happened in 1948, but they made a decision to go another way. Okay, fine. And then 4 years later, when you had these mass sightings in over a period of 18 days, I believe it was, in Washington, D.C., that really scared the hell out of everybody. There weren't a lot of cameras. There were no cell phones. To my knowledge, not a single photograph exists, but I'm sure maybe a few were taken. There have been some reconstructions. But this was a big deal, and they had to have press conferences, and it caused a lot of turmoil. At that point, they could have made the decision, look, if these things are going to fly over the capital of the United States whenever the hell they want to, do we really want to try to continue this particular truth embargo, this embargo on this issue? And they could have started the process and done some, brought in people, interviewed them, looked at legislation, whatever. They could have gone through the process we're seeing now in 1952, 53. We'd have gotten disclosure back then. Then the Cold War really got going. And the next opportunity would have been 1993, when Rockefeller goes to the Clinton administration. The Cold War is over. The Communist Party has been outlawed. The Soviet Union is gone, is lost. 14 republics have turned capitalist. Hey, we won. It's great. Things are a lot better. We feel, you know, safer now. And Clinton was trying to get the UFO files. They could have done it then, but they didn't. They decided, no, we'll keep going. 30 more years. All right. So finally, but again, now what happened in those 30 years, right? When they make the decision, yeah, the truth embargo, we can keep this going. We can keep it going for another 100 years. You know, we're really good at this. And then came Google. And then came Twitter, Facebook rather, and then came Twitter, and then came podcasts, and then came cell phones, and a massive global communication network where you could, you know, a sighting or a case could happen, and it's on the other side of the world in an hour, and researchers are sharing all their work, and essentially the knowledge base globally is just growing exponentially, and they're sitting there watching this going, boy, going to be kind of hard to keep this going. All right. And so at some point it broke. And that was 2017. And so they came forward, and then the process appropriately gets underway. And what is the appropriate way? Okay. First of all, you get the journalists involved. You get them to start really covering it seriously. That's happened. Secondly, you start making language changes. You get away from the discredited and corrupted language of the truth embargo, UFO, you move to UAP. You don't use cover up, you use truth embargo. You try to use extraterrestrial, not alien. In other words, you start using language that fits the reality.
The vernacular
language of your oppressor. Okay? So that is going on. All right. And so then the stigma starts to fall off. All right. That's great. That's happening. And that stigma and new language makes it easier for the people who have something to lose, like members of Congress, right, and officials over at the DOD and what have you, right, to get involved. And so that's happening. Meanwhile, and this is probably some of the most important stuff that happened, in the period from 2000, pretty much mid-18, up until recently, and essentially, you had witnesses going up on the Hill to give private briefings to members of Congress. Now, we don't know how many, but I think it's a substantial number. In terms of the number of members of Congress been briefed, we don't know, but I think it's in three figures easily. Mm-hmm. And so year after year, for several years and months, you've got those pilots going up there, you've got other witnesses going up there, and they're giving private briefings to members of Congress. Now, the individual, I believe, that is most responsible for organizing this, but he's not the only one, is a gentleman by the name of Christopher Mellon. Because of his background, both at the DOD and in Congress, he was the perfect person. He had the credentials to be able to set these meetings up and be there in the room. And so he is essentially prepping all of the key members of Congress in the key committees, Intel, Armed Services, possibly Homeland Security, and so forth, about the testimony and the witnesses that are out there privately. In other words, it wasn't a classified briefing per se, but it was a private briefing that we're not going to give a press conference. We're not going to talk about it. And by and large, that was the case. A few members did mention they were briefed. A couple of witnesses mentioned that they maybe talked to somebody, but overall, it was kept private. It was in the best interest of everybody to do so, because the Congress needed time, the current members needed time to get up to speed. What is going on? What is the testimony? And so forth. And
guess what? Harry Reid was probably the bravest among them.
Well, he goes all the way back. I mean, I'm talking about what's happened now, just the last 3 years. He served his role. He has his place. But that goes all the way back to 2007. I mean, in other words, he was way ahead of his time. Now we're in the current present time. And so what did those briefings lead to? Exactly what they should lead to. Legislation. And so after the entire Senate Intel Committee had been briefed, probably by, I say, in various ways at various times, Marco Rubio turns out to be the first member of Congress to make a move. Yep. In this era of the final days of the truth embargo, he is the first member to make a move. Now, there were other members of Congress that tried to do things years ago, but it wasn't part of this process, and it didn't go anywhere, but they deserve historical credit, like Stephen Schiff. I hope that he receives what he's deserved. And there's a couple of senators and so forth, but this is different. So Rubio makes the first move, and by putting in UAP-related legislation into, he slips it into the COVID relief bill, which is an omnibus bill, right? Yep. Huge bill, funding and all that kind of stuff. He slips that in there to set up a UAP task force, okay? All right, which basically put the DOD on notice. We're here now.
Yeah.
The Senate is now stepping into this. Here's a little legislation to get you going. And one of the things it did was ask for a report at a certain time. And it turned out the deadline, based upon when the bill was signed, was June 25. And so this is brilliant on the part of Marco Rubio, because what he did was he hung out a MacGuffin for all of the media to jump on, meaning I am demanding a report by the 25th of June. And so now all the media is getting ready to cover that when it comes, and it's just building up the interest. And so when the report finally comes out at the last minute, not surprisingly, they jumped all over it, made a lot of articles. And of course, Marco Rubio was mentioned in a lot of this coverage over that entire 7-8 month period.
Yep.
Now, in addition to the unclassified report that was issued on 25, 8 pages, it was not a big deal, but it was important. There was an unclassified report given to those members of Congress that had been briefed already, taking it to another level. And that was legislation one. Then comes legislation two. Okay. Legislation two was the 2022 NDAA, National Defense Authorization Act, and of course the intelligence authorization component. And language was put together there. And in this case, Kirsten Gillibrand is when she stepped in. All right. Kirsten Gillibrand steps in, and she's one of the principal architects. So I'm sure that both Rubio and Warner were involved. But for whatever reason, she ended up being the front person on this. You know, could that because she was a woman and we need to get the women involved here? Is it also because she was a very powerful senator and she ran for president? All right, as did Rubio.
Yes.
And so now she's kind of the front there. Meanwhile, Ruben Gallego down in the House is going, hey, it's time for us to get something going. So he's putting some language in the House bill. They come together in resolution, and out comes that legislation, which called for an expansion of the program. It called for, it had a different name and so forth and so forth. It's a big deal. And then we move on a little further, and what happens? We get the third major piece of legislation, and that's the 2023 NDAA Act. And that really takes it to another level. And at this point, the Department of Defense, every single military service and every intelligence agency agents know if they have, you know, that by then, that this thing is now underway. It is irreversible. The Congress is involved. There is legislation. We're going to have to do all of that stuff that we didn't do in 48, 53, and 93. And why are we doing all of that? So we can get to a place where the president can finally confirm the issue.
Yes.
And the road to that final moment must pass through Congress. You see, the military services and the DOD cannot disclose this issue. It's not their job. It's completely out of line. It would violate the Constitution.
Yes,
the Congress can't do it either. This is a national security matter of national offense. And so a statement regarding something at this level must come from the president, but the Congress must be involved. And how? Hearings. Mm-hmm. In other words, the hearings that we've been trying to get since 1968 are finally going to happen. The two things we just experienced in the last 2 years were not hearings, they were briefings, not the same thing. Moultrie, Bray, and Kirkpatrick did not take an oath before they sat down. They just sat down and answered questions from a senator or senators. These were briefings. These were not hearings. Hearings is when people sit down under oath and give information. Okay?
Yeah.
So you have to have those. Why? Because it satisfies the key components of protocol to get this done right. What are they? One, it involves the military and the Department of Defense, because they're the ones that are providing the military witnesses. They're the ones that hired these people. They served in the military services. They served at the DOD. And so the DOD is involved there. And of course, now that there is a program set up, ARRO, All Domain Anomaly Resolution Office, that is involved. Okay, it involves the Congress. You've got committees, and all of these members of these committees are sitting there, and they're going to get to ask questions, all right, of these military witnesses who are under oath, and they could ask anything they want. And they're going to be watched by millions of people, because these things are going to be, they're going to be broadcast live, I can assure you. And so they're getting recognition, they're doing their job, the DOD is involved and so forth. But the third component is the American people are involved. They are going to watch these hearings with every bit the same intensity of the Iran-Contra hearing, actually greater intensity than the Iran-Contra hearings and the Watergate hearing, et cetera, any of the hearings, pick them. This is going to surpass them. And so what you have is a transparent process going on involving all of the appropriate players. And it unfolds over a period of a week or 2 or 3 weeks, and the testimony is going to be mind-blowing. Now, how do I know this is about to happen? Because the one thing that had to happen before the hearings began is that the DOD's organization, ARRO, and the committee staff of the appropriate committees that will do these hearings have got to pre-interview the witnesses. Absolutely, have to pre-interview the witnesses.
Of course, they need to know in advance what's going to be said.
You need to know what their key testimony is. You need to vet them, of course, but certainly you need to know the testimony so that the members of Congress can ask the right questions when they sit down. All right, and there's no surprises. You also be able to sort out ahead of time what is going to have to be in a classified setting and what can be in a unclassified setting. Once those pre-interviews are done, then you can hold the hearings. And when those hearings are held, people need to know this. One, they're not going to lie, period. They're just not going to lie. Every one of these military witnesses got two oaths, one when they signed up to serve, and the second one when they sat down at that table. They don't have to lie, and they're not going to lie. And one of the reasons they're not going to lie is because if any question is asked of them that they can't answer, they don't have to come up with a false answer. All right. They will have to do is say, Senator, in that regard to that question, I can discuss it, but only in private classified setting. I cannot do it here. And they'll go, fine. We will discuss that then. So they're not going to lie. All right. Secondly, the members of Congress, regardless of what the pre-interviews have accomplished, they can ask anything they want. They can do anything they want. And so In those hearings, which are going to be watched by millions of people, the committee members are going to have the opportunity to stake their claim to this subject, to this historical moment. And they may just not just ask questions. They may have statements to make. They may want to put on a little bit of a show, but they are going to. Okay. And of course, this is going to take the whole thing to another level. And so they're going to ask, and of course, the committee witnesses will give an initial statement. Once the questions begin, they can say anything they want. If they violate a national security decree or a non-disclosure agreement, that could get them in hot water. I don't think they'll do that.
They won't.
And so that is going to go on for a couple of weeks, and that's it. Now the table has now been completely set for the president to end the truth embargo.
Right.
And here's why it has to be that way, because under that circumstance, all of the key people, all the key players and agencies have played their role. They've done their part. They've been transparent, right? Which is what people have to have on this now. And the evidence has been presented in front of everybody. And the evidence that can be stated in the public domain, I assure you, is more than enough to absolutely close the deal. And then the stuff that's done in unclassified setting, well, a classified setting, yeah, that's even more. We'll get to that eventually. And so the president, it's going to be watching these hearings take place, as well as everybody else in the government. There's going to be hardly anybody in the government's not watching these things take place. And so the evidence piles up before the world's people. By the way, it'll be broadcast worldwide.
Worldwide.
Then the president can come forward and in a totally nonpartisan way,
yeah,
with no political overtones, to a world that has already figured out, yeah, it's true, and say to them, my fellow Americans, I have watched these extraordinary weeks of testimony from these members of our military, these people that have served our country and our national interest. My aides have watched it. I have talked with my people at the Pentagon, or the top people at the Pentagon. I've talked with congressional leaders, and we have all come to agreement that this testimony clearly confirms that the phenomena in question, the phenomena that matters, is non-human intelligence in origin and construction from somewhere. He doesn't have to use the word extraterrestrial. Everybody right. will get that. And that's disclosure. That's it. It's over. It is done. And now begins the post-disclosure world. And the reason there's so much cognitive dissonance is that people keep thinking that this process is to finally tell us the truth. No, it is to get this to the point where the president can confirm that simple truth. Therefore, we can then begin what will end up being endless months of hearings in which all the aspects of this issue are engaged by the Congress with new sets of witnesses, and slowly information that has been withheld starts to come out, all right? And the catch, though, is that in order to do this, they have to lie their way out of the lie.
Of the lie, exactly.
And that is what is driving people crazy. In other words, they have to stay between the lines. They can't say what they fully know.
Right.
It's not simply a matter of NDAs. It's like, look, this needs to go this way, and I just can't go rogue. Now, there are some people going rogue, okay?
Yeah.
All right, there's a few. And probably the best example of rogues, Tim Burchett, mm-hmm. right? Tim Burchett figured out there's something going on. And he is a member of, he's not a potted plant. And so he can't go a week without getting in front of a camera and saying, the ZT's here, we have technology. That is not enough to disrupt this process, all right? So you're going to see a certain amount of that. But they cannot properly represent what they know and why they're doing it, because that then undermines this process, which leads to an orderly, constructive, and minimally disruptive outcome of disclosure. So in some regard, it is what I have frequently called and love to call, because this is my phrase, I own this puppy. What we are seeing is a public relations-driven extrication process to end the truth embargo formally, so that we no longer have to go through this again.
Yes. God bless you, Stephen. We are out of time. My show has just come to an end. I hope everybody heard the last couple of sentences that you just said. I will have you back on at your convenience to pick up where we left off. And I consider you one of the brightest stars in the firmament. And I thank you from my heart for joining me tonight.
Lastly, I'm going to be speaking at the Contact in the Desert Conference, June 2 to 4. It is massive. It is 60 speakers. It is huge. Please join me there. Yes. And also, I promise the next time I'll have better lighting.
Okay. You're precious in every way, in any lighting. I love you, dear. I'll talk to you soon. Thank you. Bye. Good night, honey.